All right, folks. We got 3 meetings left.
Three meetings and a final, or just
three classes and then a final exam. All right. Is that next week? I know, it's crazy, right?
Insane.
Think of all those things you learned. You knew nothing when you came in. About security.
You probably knew a lot of other stuff, too. I'm not trying to disparage your knowledge coming into this course.
You crafted us out of the clay.
I what?
You crafted us out of the clay.
Yeah, I mean, molding young minds is what I do. That's what it is. All right. Before we get started, is something we decide? Yes.
Just wanted to ask about the final.
When that's what we need to decide.
What is it going to be?
Do you want a final exam?
No. Oh, we don't.
Do you want to take an exam for an hour and 15 minutes?
No.
More difficult questions that I come up with to probe your knowledge of everything you learned in the past 3 weeks plus the last, was it 12 weeks?
No. How do I take this up?
Nobody wants to admit it in front of a bunch of people yelling no.
Extra credit?
Extra credit, final exam. That's a good track. You never, you gotta ask. Here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking we will do, you can call it maybe, since we've already done several CTFs throughout the year, right? So the CTFs plus your project report will comprise your project grade. And then your team's effort, so your team will get a grade for the final. So the final CTF will be in lieu of a written final.
Woo-hoo.
How does that sound?
And the project report is one per team, or is it?
Yes, project report is one per team.
Sounds awesome.
Does that make sense?
Can you repeat that?
Can I repeat that? Yes. So your project grade, so you have a project report, you have a project to do, correct?
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes.
Yes. So you also have done 3 in-class capture the flags, which were all leading up to the project. So all of that will comprise your project. The final CTF that we're having on the 30th? On the 30th. That will count as your final. So basically, in lieu of a written final, you will take a CTF final as a team.
For the 2 hours?
For the 2 hours. I think it's an hour and 50, so I think 2 hours. You will be super well prepared for it because you've done 3 in-class CTFs, and you've developed awesome tools to help you win the final CTF.
When do we have to submit the project report?
It's on the website. By that date. I think it's 2 days after the final.
The second.
The second. Yes. Okay, it's a good plan. Let's do it.
And we don't have any other individual projects, right?
Correct. It's a group project. The project is a group project. You have your project groups you decided from the beginning of the semester.
Yes. How long will the final CEF be online for?
That's a good question. How long will
it
be online?
We needed to extend the other CTFs, right?
Yeah, I think we can put it online until the project deadline. How about that? We'll announce the winner at the end of the final CTF, at the end of the minute 50, but we'll leave it open for sure now. So
our previous CTFs are going to our project.
Yes.
And the project that we are going to finish the CTF, is that also going into that project?
Yes. Okay. 3 CTFs plus your project report.
And then that's like 10% or whatever.
Yes.
Final is the final.
Yes. Makes sense. I think that's a fair mix.
Is there going to be another homework assignment?
No more homework assignments. It's not enough time. Otherwise, that one. Contrary to your opinions, I don't want you completely alone. All the time. Yeah.
So, what if we say services or you will be changing the
services? Ah, come on. Think about it and tell me what you're going to do.
So we got the.
Hey folks!
Can somebody whistle?
Yeah,
nice.
Wow, that's pretty good.
We got an email with all our marks so far.
Yes.
Can you tell us what the breakdown is and how that contributes to like the?
It's
other
already on the website.
No, but okay. How does the 50% assignments? How does that? Is it those 3 assignments 50%?
Yes.
And then the CTFs go under the project.
Yes.
Okay.
Easy.
Let's
get to it. We got three more web security classes so I can train you to be excellent web security hackers. Okay. If you have any questions, you know where to email. All right. So, switching gears. Can somebody give me an example of where mixing coded data in the same channel causes a security vulnerability?
Forms.
Forms. What does that mean?
There's JavaScript running.
Kind of. We'll see that later. But we have better examples. Yeah.
You said executable stack, right? So.
Yeah, the stack is executable, right? So you literally are storing the user's data in the same on the same channel, literally the same contiguous memory that you also store pointers of where you go and execute things. Right? So the fact that you have user data intermixed with essentially your control flow means that a user, think about if you could completely prevent any type of Stack Overflow nonsense if there was a completely separate user data stack and a completely separate, basically EIP stack,
like
and Harvard. Never the two could ever mix.
Like a Harvard architecture.
Like what?
Harvard architecture.
Yes, like a, yes.
That's separate.
Harvard architecture, yes. Yeah. So when you look at the von Neumann architecture versus the Harvard architecture, exactly. So that was the one of the original styles of how you design a CPU, and the von Neumann architecture won out, and so now we have to deal with this problem forever. And as we'll see, almost every single example, a lot of web security vulnerabilities are framed, and you can think about them in this idea, but this should be a general idea that you can take to any new thing, where literally, for instance, let's say you're talking to a web service that's generating JSON output. Right, where JSON, so your user input is used to create a JSON response. Right, in that case, the data would be the data contained inside each element of the JSON entry. But if you can break out of that and add or change or manipulate the JSON from your input, you could potentially change and compromise the security of the application. So the first thing we're gonna look at is our old friend, OS command injection attacks. So what were command injection attacks when we looked at binaries? Nobody remembers?
No, there's no final.
Yeah, just all melted away. Alright.
Final's
back on and let you answer any questions. I will decide at the end of class.
I wouldn't do that, that would be good.
Was this like where we were able to utilize semicolons, restricted characters to chain together commands in a way that wasn't initially intended for by the program?
Yeah, so what's like a vulnerable function in C that we would look at? System, so I said system or vopen, right? The idea is the problem there is you pass a string into system, which then binsh would parse and interpret that as some essentially shell command. But, and so similarly here, the same thing happens in a web application where you can concatenate strings together and pass it to literally sometimes the same functions like system. So the idea is you have either completely no validation or incorrect validation. So system, in the web though, now we have a different kind of context. We have eval. So what's eval do? Yes.
Takes a string and then executes it.
Yeah, takes a string, not just executes it, right? Takes a string, the runtime language interprets it as whatever language, so let's talk PHP. So it takes a string, parses it as if it's PHP code, creates an abstract syntax tree, and then starts executing it as if that code was in there always to begin with. And questions on what execution environment it has, what variables and what scope it has are language dependent. But in essence, it's turning a string into code. So if you can control the code that goes to an eval, you could then inject any arbitrary, let's say, PHP code, which means you can read any file, do anything that the PHP code could do. The same as a remote code execution. Similarly, vopen, include is could be another one, or require. We're going to look at that, though. But let's look at an example. So The idea would be some either CGI program or PHP application that wants to, let's say you're writing an application and you have a list of bad passwords that can't be used, like a dictionary or something. You want to make sure that their password is not in the dictionary. And you want to follow the privilege of not reinventing, or privilege, the principle of not reinventing the wheel. So you can use the grep command. Grep is great at looking through files for other characters. So you do something like grep, this $exp is going to be the expression, and then whatever the phone book, this would be a phone book application. So you've seen already an example of this in the CTF3 and in the homework assignment, where by putting backticks in there or by doing the /binsh, the cat thing that we were looking at, you can get a shell there. Here's one case where it's kind of cool. You're using the mail command. So here you're emailing a file to yourself, so the etc password file, and then removing the phonebook.txt because you're super mean. So the way to think about, well, you fix this is easy. Just like on the command line, you put double quotes around strings and around arguments on the command line. And this will help because now the previous one would break if there was any spaces. Right? It wouldn't be grepping for the right thing. So is this safe? Like, go home, never go home, we're secure now?
No.
No, why not?
It's added, you put this added,
okay? Yeah, because now all we need is a double quote to end the original double quote. And then what do we need?
Another.
Yeah, semicolon, and then whatever we want, whatever our payload is. And then what? Yeah, we need to somehow deal with this ending double quote, because no matter what we put in, right, and this is where it comes from, literally, the way to think about this is the runtime is concatenating strings together, right? This grep space double quote is being concatenated with whatever our expression is, which is always being concatenated with a double quote space phonebook.txt. So you need to have whatever you said be able to be parsed by bash, or binsh, because otherwise it's not going to execute. So if you have a trailing double quote, bash is going to say, hey, this is a syntax error, it's not a valid command. So you need to be able to handle that. So you can handle that by, I guess actually this one doesn't, and so that's bad. So that would not actually work. So in the case of a different languages, let's say PHP here, depending on the implementation of system, you may be able to pass in multiple arguments here. So this, in this case, this would be similar to using execve, where you explicitly say, I have, what is this, 1, 2, 3, 4, I have 4 arguments to the program. So argv is only going to be 4. It's going to execute grep, it's going to pass e, and then no matter what you pass in with exp, right, essentially you can think of it as this is parsing that string. Right? We're not using spaces now to separate the arguments and telling bash or binsh to parse that for us. What we're doing is we are pre-parsing it and basically telling the system call, or this call to the system function, that these are the 4 arguments I'm going to use. And I'm never going to use any more arguments, so it's not possible to create new arguments. Don't do any parsing. Questions? All right, so this is actually very tricky to get right because you need to be very precise about what sanitization routine you use. So for instance, if you look at this escape shell argument, it says add single quotes around a string and quotes escapes any existing single quotes, allowing one to pass a string directly to a shell function and having it to be treated as a single safe argument. So this means it's doing, so if you put that within double quotes, you may be messing things up because you're essentially double quoting it and then adding single quotes inside of it. Whereas escape shell command escapes any characters in a string that might be used to trick a shell command into executing arbitrary commands, and then it lists all the different strings, are escaped only if they are not, oh wait, this one, yeah, yeah. Tick and double quote are, or single quote, double quote are escaped only if they're not there. So we, as attackers, so if we think about what's our goal with attacking a website, so what does an OS command injection give us the ability to do?
server? Can we access every bit of data on the server? What are we limited to access?
The context of the user running the...
Yeah, the context of the user, the web server, which in most distros it's going to be like www-data. Right? So whatever that user can see. But if we start from the thing where we have no access to any files on the system, we're completely remote attackers, that now gives us additional access where now we are local attackers and we can do the other types of tricks we talked about, like set-UID attacks. Cool. So our goal is essentially to, and we can read things, but we can also execute any arbitrary commands. Right? We're not just limited to read files. We can literally do anything we want. So as we saw in PHP, when we looked at PHP, PHP has a nice way for you to break up your functionality into different files. Just like when you're writing C, you use include, or when you're using Java, you can include some other class, right? Which allows you to separate the functionality into different modules and include what you need to get the job done. So many languages have this, but the difference is, especially with in terms of C or even Java, when is that inclusion done? In C or Java?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Too many Java star languages. Yeah.
So it includes the stuff in the file.
Right, but when does it include that? Does it include it when you compile it, right? To compile it, it needs, in C, it needs the headers, in Java, it needs the Java classes or any jars that you're using. So when you compile it, it needs to know all that information, and then depending on how you compile it, as we saw, maybe we'll dynamically load it, but it doesn't need to go find random C files and include them. This is in stark contrast to a language like PHP, where the inclusion is done at runtime. So while the PHP code and while the PHP interpreter is executing each line, when it gets to a line that says include this string or variable, it evaluates that to a string and tries to find that file to parse that file as PHP code. So what does this mean that we can do as attackers if we control the PHP code? Or if we can control, sorry, that string.
The included string?
The included string. You just volunteered yourself for an answer.
And you could redirect to different PHP code.
Yeah, we can maybe try to point it to a file that we uploaded. Or maybe we can point it to a non, I mean, depending, so what does PHP do when it interprets a file that does not have PHP tags? It prints it. It just prints it. So if we can get it to include etc password, that will just show us the etc password file or any other file that we have access to. And so not only could we maybe upload code into some file, and in this case it doesn't even need to end with the .php extension because the PHP interpreter doesn't care at that point because you're telling it explicitly to include this file. We can upload some code somewhere on the same system as long as the data user can access it, then now we've ran custom code of our choosing on the remote server. We can also, if, as we saw, PHP has that facility that you can do remote file include, so you can include http://, file, or you can include sometimes an FTP file, all kinds of weird, literally, you start digging around in this, this is super weird of all the things you can include. And you may be able to try to influence or change the path. So this is the directive or the configuration option, allow URL F open. And so, yeah, let's say this is our main app.php. It has a variable called include path. /includes. It's going to include includePath.library.php, and then in library.php, it uses the variable includePath to include math.php. And so now here we're chaining kind of two behaviors here. So we're using The register global. So we're assuming the code is using register globals, and this is yet another instance where register globals is terrible. Because the way file inclusion is done in PHP, it's essentially copy that file and paste it in right there, including the scope and everything. So this means a file that you include, for instance, here gets access to all the variables that are defined at that point, which means it's very useful in this other include path, this library.php, to use a variable that was defined before you called it. Yes?
So could you include your own PHP and then overwrite the variable too as well to like overwrite the global variable? And then
yes,
the scope?
You could definitely do that, but at that point, once you can execute PHP code, it's game over. You don't really care about all the variables. Like, you could write a shell out, you can do all kinds of fun stuff.
Got it.
There's PHP shells, so if you want to get into this, you can get PHP shells. So let's say we have this example here where we're calling library.php, we're setting the include path, we know that it has register globals. What file is going to be included by the remote PHP code? Yes. http://www.eagle.com/math.php. Why math.php?
It's getting appended.
Yes, always getting appended. Right? So this means if we point this to a domain we control, create a file there that's math.php, and we have to be careful to not interpret that PHP code because we want to ship a source PHP file, right? Not the result of executing that PHP code. If we include that there, then that will be included at runtime and executed on that system. Questions on this? It's pretty cool. You can also briefly mention it. I don't know if they changed this behavior in newer versions of PHP, but you used to be able to deal with appending the things that got appended. If you made a request, and then if this was the URL you wanted, and you did %00 at the end, what does that become? What's %00 get URL decoded as?
It's a null.
As a null byte, which then PHP includes just fine, and then appends math.php. So you have http://www.eagle.com/null/byte/math.php, and then when PHP takes that and sends that to system, like syscalls, right, to fopen this or URL get, what is the underlying runtime language of PHP use?
Before.
Like what does syscall, what do syscalls use when you pass like a in the operating system? What was that? I mean, in general, like system calls, like when you call into the operating system, what, how do you pass values into a system call, like read or write or open? What was that? Yeah, but what's the data type?
String.
A character pointer, a C null terminated string.
Yeah.
So if that, you pass that data in there and it includes a null byte, then that system call will completely ignore anything after that and will only execute up to there. I think in like the very latest versions I've seen of PHP, they have a weird thing that detects this behavior. Do you remember that, Connor? Yeah, but it still definitely still happens, and so it's a nice way to evade and get around, especially in older versions of PHP. Cool, okay.
Yes. You said math.php has to be, like the fake math.php has to be done in such a way that it's run by this.
So let's think about exactly what's happening. So we have, so there's three players here. There's us, or our, the system that's making the request. There's the server that's vulnerable, and then there's our evil.com server. So we make the request, this request we saw here. This backend server is gonna process that request. It's gonna do the include, it's gonna try to include evil.com/math.php, which means it's going to make an HTTP request to evil.com, /map.php, and whatever gets back in the HTTP body of that request, it will interpret as PHP code. So you need to send it back something with PHP commands, with open tag and close tags. But if you throw that on a server that's executing PHP files, those will not be output unless you do it in a weird way.
What if evil.com by default outputs map.php? By default, without even, just evil.com/will give map.php as output without even appending that. If we control the files on evil.com.
Yeah, if we control the files, it doesn't matter. For the root, we can tell it, like, do this, like, output this. So yeah, we just need to be careful. We actually don't even need, for something like this, we don't even need to, we wouldn't need to run a whole web server. We can just run some. So we can change the port to make it go to any port, and we can run like netcat to output whatever we want. So we can output the start of an HTTP response with the body of whatever we want, and that will be interpreted. Cool. All right, let's go to the next example. So we talked about that web applications very frequently use a database. Why do they do that? Why not use files? Are files much easier?
Because
that's a good one, no.
Two users, they want to access the file at the same time. There's a limitation on opening the file.
Exactly, there's no, remember with a web application, any user can make any HTTP request at any time, right? And this means you can have multiple concurrent requests. So if you just use files, you'd have to use file locking, so you could have only one person accessing a file necessarily at a time, or you'd be completely destroying the throughput of your application because every request would have to lock whatever file you're using, use it, and then the next one would spin until it got access. Databases are designed to solve these types of concurrency problems. And how do web applications, like we saw, how do they query the database?
Connect HTTP. If it is running on the local machine, then they use local hosts.
Right, I mean it'll connect, but how does the code of the web application make queries to the database? Yeah.
So the client will send some parameters that this is what the data want, and based on that parameters, it will create an SQL query, and that query will be sent to the database.
Yes, so MySQL queries, right? So there's a structured query language, right? SQL, structured query language, that is defined, which is how people and also web applications query data from the SQL database. So fundamentally, for the web application to get or put any data into the web, into the database, it needs to issue SQL queries. As we've seen, and again, what often ends up happening is web developers will issue SQL queries by concatenating strings together. So they'll have the first part, select star from users, where username is equal to $ username and password is equal to $ password.
So let's envision that we have this beautiful web page with a username and password. Anybody see a login page before? Anybody see a login page on Internet Explorer 6? Just me.
Recently?
I mean, besides the one you're looking at right here. I hope not recently. That'd be terrible, unless you're one of these web developers that has to develop sites that's still working on E6. But do they still do that? Does anyone have that as part of their job description? Yeah, I would imagine. And also, you got to think of a lot of corporations. They bought some big, whatever, timesheet management software in the early 2000s, and it only runs on IE6, because it's using features of IE6, so that's why they still have copies of this thing around, so people can use that. It's actually cheaper for them than rewriting the whole application and fixing it to just force the employees to use let's just call it a super old web browser. Cool, okay, so when we dig in, so always, when we're looking at web applications, we gotta dig in and look at the source. And the source in this case means the HTML of the page. So we wanna look at the HTML source here and say, okay, there's a form with an action of login dot ASP, method is post. Again, you can turn this, submitting this form into an HTTP request. Because we're super old school, we're gonna use tables to do the layout rather than CSS. So we have a table, and the things we care about are input fields. So we have an input of type text name username, an input of type password name password, and a submit button or a reset button. Pretty standard. So if we look at the login script, so I know we did brief cover ASP, it's very similar to PHP. This is one of the things with dealing with the web, you never know. Because you never know what the backend web server code is written in. So you may have to deal with things that are written in Node.js, or which is JavaScript, or Ruby, or Python, or ASP.NET, or Java, or some other ones.
Python.
Go. I haven't actually. I'm sure it happens. I think Go is used in a lot of backend services. I don't know about the application itself. C++. Ooh, that'd be really bad. I don't know. Lua. Yeah, lots of stuff. Lisp. Anyways, I could go on. Lisp is awesome. Reddit was the first version of Reddit was written in Lisp. Before they rewrote it into Python, I believe.
And Hacker News still is.
Yes, and a weird version of ARC. Anyways, okay, so the backend code is very much what you'd expect for a logging function. So what would you expect a logging function to do? Get the username and password from the request and do what with it?
Compare it against the database.
Compare it against the database. Check, is there a user with this username and password? You should take other security classes to learn how to actually implement this with hashing and salt and all that, but we'll ignore that for now. So we get the username and password from the request. Super easy. This, you can think of these are helper methods that are parsing it from the URL in the HTTP request, right? So we don't need to go into the details here. It's then creating essentially a connection to a database, so we know there's going to be some database connection. It's then creating the query, right? Again, this is what needs to happen. It needs to make a query to the database. And it selects from pubs.guest.satable where username is equal to username and password equals to password, right? This is what we want to check. We want to say, does a user exist in our database that has been given the username and password? And then we make the query on the database, and then what do we do after that? How do we know if the user is a valid username and password?
If the count is the return.
If the what? What do we check about the return?
Well, it's going to either give you a, because this is going to be a Boolean check, right? So it's going to either give you true or false.
Nope. This is going to give me every user in that table, so every row in that table that matches these query parameters. That has the username of what I gave and a password of what I gave. So it's not a Boolean yet, although login we may want a Boolean from login, right? Depending on how we wrote that. But we need to figure out whether the authentication was true or false, depending. And so essentially they're using the count, basically. How many rows are returned? If there are no rows returned, then there does not exist a user in the database with the given username and the given password. And say access denied, otherwise say that access was granted and do other stuff and set cookies and associate the cookie with the session and blah, 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 all that fun stuff. So the key problem here is that this SQL query is being constructed by concatenating strings. And here it's very clear that string concatenation is occurring, right? Because it's literally concatenating strings. It's not even using anything tricky like PHP with $foo embedded into some string, or it's doing the string interpretation, which Connor loves. So we can look at the database. There's some users in here. And so if we're an attacker and we want to get into this log into this web application, without knowing a user. So if we already know a username and password, do we care? No, maybe not. We can already get in, right? What if we don't know a username and password?
Let's just ask for one.
Just what?
Just ask for one.
Ask for one?
Yeah. Ask for use a SQL query to get the username.
Yeah, we'll get there. But
okay.
We're building up.
Okay.
I thought you meant to ask, like, Bob for his password.
Sure.
Which is basically phishing, so yes, that works.
Do that too.
So let's work backwards. Where are we trying to get? Where are we trying to essentially force the execution to go in this login script?
The else condition
of access granted. So work backwards. So what has to be true in order for us to get there? Yeah, there needs to be, we need this rso.eof to be false, which means we need there to be rows return. So there's one way we can do that, right? We can put in the username and password that we know, and that row will be returned. Do we know a username and password? No, we do not. But our input from username and password, actually, let's draw a picture here. I haven't drawn in a long time, at least in this class. Oh, it's so nice. Okay. I know you've all missed it. All right. So we have, let's go text here. Paste. Yes, I know pasting is tricky. So let's think of it. And again, it all comes down to parsing, just like with the system and the popen calls. So what's going to happen? We're going to select star from blah, I'm not going to write that, where username is equal to, and then single quote, and then something that we put, single quote, and password is equal to single quote. Again, the second thing we wrote, single quote. Right? So, whatever we put for username will be substituted in the first single quotes. Whatever we substitute as the second, as the password we put into the second quotes. And then what happens when our web application takes these bytes and sends it to the SQL server?
Expands.
What is it?
It'll expand the literal into a SQL query. That's what you're asking.
Be more specific. So what is it? So what does the SQL server get from us, the web application? No, it does not get a SQL query. It gets bytes. It gets the byte for S, the byte for E, the byte for L, the byte for E, the byte for C, T, space, blah, 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 blah. Maybe until the new line. I actually don't know the exact SQL query syntax, the data transfer syntax on these sockets, but essentially, it's transmitting this as bytes. And then what does the SQL server have to do? It has to parse it, right? It has to parse those bytes and say, is this a SQL query? And then if so, what are the semantics of that SQL query? So from the parsing, it builds a parse tree and says, these are the SQL keywords, it's a select query, it's querying on this table, and it has this where clause of this username and this password. So what our goal is here is, can we give input to, because we can, were there any restrictions that we saw on what we can put in for username and password?
No. Well, it has to be string literal, right? So.
What does that mean?
Meaning that the enclosed SQL query is going to have encapsulating. Like it has to be, it starts with a single quote and ends with a single quote.
The question is, this username variable comes from request.form username. So there's no checks on the server-side code that says there's no spaces or that there's only alphanumeric characters, right? So basically, anything we give for the username parameter will be input here. Great. So now, we can put anything in for this username, right? So what if we just put like foo space bar?
No.
Right? And again, remember, it all comes down to the SQL server parsing this, who will take this, parse this, say, ah, this is a select query of all columns from this table, and it has these clauses, right? And foobar was just a username equals foobar. So the goal is, can we actually change the syntax of this query by giving different input?
Yeah.
So how can we do that?
What input do you want?
I would do do it in single quote.
Single quote?
And then or username equal star. Isn't that like return? I don't think you have to enclose it in single quotes, right?
Wait, let's just keep going.
Okay.
So we're putting in our input here. Star space.
Or, right?
Or
user,
yeah, kind of sideways.
Username equals star. Because I think the query, you don't do single quotes around like asterisks, right? It'll do it expensive.
I think it depends on the SQL engine. Let's say this, well, we'll figure it out.
Okay. Otherwise, I would just do star instead of or usernames. So, you know what I mean?
Okay. Yes. Okay. So this, so just to be 100% clear, this is our input, right?
Right. And then you have to like or like username.
We want more input?
Well, I'm just saying to enclose the second.
Okay, yeah, that's good. So let's stop for a minute. So let's say we did tick or username equals star, we'll put foobar in for password. When the SQL server gets this sequence of bytes, what is it going to do? It's going to do what? More specific.
Because you know there's another single
code. Yeah, more specific. What kind of an error? A syntax error, yes, exactly. It's gonna say this is not valid syntax because you have a single quote here, a single quote here, a single quote here, and a single quote here, so you have a non-matching single quote. Why can't we just get rid of all of this garbage?
Because it's part of the string.
Because it's part of the, it's not just part of the string, it's part of the code that executes every single time this script executes. Right? By concatenating strings together, no matter what we give, there will always be this single quote space and password equals space single quote. So we can't just get rid of it as much as we would like to. So how can we handle this part?
Do another clause.
Huh?
Do another clause.
Clause?
No.
What kind of clause do you want? You're the one writing.
I just did the or because I wasn't sure, like, I could
do
some asterisks. Yeah, I could do another or, and then or username equal, like, username equal another single quote. Just repeat the first where, just the, or I guess we could even, no.
Like that?
Yeah, that's fine.
So that'll match with this?
Yeah, and then it'll be equivalent to the other.
So now we have username is equal to empty string, which would probably never match.
Right.
Or username is equal to star, match everything. Or username is equal to single quote and password equals to something. So there's a little bit of things here. I'm not 100% sure about how the ands and the ors will parse by the SQL engine, whether it's leftmost or rightmost or I don't know. It's a little bit risky because you have this additional and password clause here. So it's good. So the idea here is username equals star should match everything. We can also basically essentially write a tautology here, or one equals one, which will match for every single row, right?
Yes.
So is SQL just for web applications?
No.
What's it also for?
Embedded
applications. Embedded applications, what else? Just computer programs to make queries? Humans, maybe like a DBA, like humans. Actually, the goal of SQL and why it looks like this is because the goal was for humans to write queries. So the idea was business people could write queries to query the database. Look at how well that's turned out.
Which means if you have SQL, which is essentially a language that was meant for humans, what do we know from... Have you ever come across code that you've wrote that you have no idea what it does? That even you yourself wrote? Go back 3 years and look at some code you wrote in class. So what's one technique we have to try to combat that?
Self-documenting
code is way too advanced.
Use variable names, that makes sense.
Yeah, those are all the nice things. What else?
Print?
Commenting, right? You write comments that say what the code should do or what the purpose of this code is, right? Sometimes you look at something like, I don't even know why this is even here. Like, what is this function even supposed to do, right? So similarly with SQL, often if you wrote some query down, it would be nice to have a comment that says what it should do, right? And unlike some SQL engines, and this is where it becomes tricky, some SQL engines use double slashes to go from here to the end of the line as a comment, and some do dash dash, and that is an end of the line comment. And so, rather than worry about this or username equals tick and the matchup with this tick,
just find the comment.
Comment it out.
Exactly, let's just comment it out. And then we don't even care what's after us at all. Dash dash, done. Right? And again, this is because when the SQL server gets these sequence of bytes, it parses it as a SQL query, and so it says, oh, a comment, ignore everything afterwards, only focus on everything before. So now we've written a query that will parse select star from this table where username is equal to empty string, which will be nothing, or 1=1. So this will return every row in the database, which will then get us past this end of file check. Cool. And this is the tick or 1=1 dash dash technique. It's kind of a mouthful, but this is the standard, like, baby's first SQL injection. So let's see if there's anything interesting here. Yes, okay, perfect. And it's all about parsing, right? So here I've styled it such that the SQL keywords aren't bold and everything in the comments after the comment is gray, so it doesn't matter what we have after that comment. Cool. And that's the basic idea. So the yes?
So what is the return? Which row is going to return when it checks 1=1?
Yes, which is true.
I know, what's going to be the return from the query?
Every single row in that table. So which, if they were checking if the number of rows returned is equal to 1, would not work. And that's why this isn't a technique. You have to tailor it to what the application is and what that source code is checking from. So in that case, maybe if you knew there was a username of admin, you knew somebody's username, you could do admin tick for and 1=1. And that would match the username who had admin and only return that one row. Cool. And this is really the core part of this technique, but the core part of this technique is not the tick or 1=1 dash dash. The key is altering the syntax of a SQL query issued by the database. And this tiny, which honestly doesn't seem like much. I mean, yes, it's nice here, you can bypass logins, you can maybe return all the rows or whatever. But it's insane. Like, even just with this one thing, you can oftentimes you can download the entire database. So you can get the entire database. You can often depending, and that's pretty much all of them, and depending on how it is, you may be able to inject additional data into the database, and you may be able to update different rows in the database, all kinds of super crazy cool stuff. So, and it depends, and again, it depends on what, because, okay, when you think about this, so using the dash dash to comment,
That affects what part of the SQL query that the web application is building? After our injection point, right, where our user input is being used, can you change what came before? No, fundamentally there's no possible way because it's concatenating strings. You can't change the bytes that are prepended to your input. You can only change the things that come afterwards. So this is why you can't just change a select into something else magically. But you can have injections into select, which does cool stuff which we talked about. You can have an injection into an insert statement where you can inject multiple entries. You can have an update statement where you could update. So here we'll be updating the password field of a certain user. But again, if you're updating the password and you set the password to be some like foobar tick dash dash, now you've changed every user's password in that database to foobar, which is just the same thing as knowing everybody's password, right? Which I think was like this class or last? I actually did that, I think it's last semester for 465. I updated the database. I was doing it manually because somebody forgot their password, and I ended up changing everybody's password in the database. But luckily, it was the end of the semester already, so nobody, I think, knew about it. But I was like, oh, that's not good. Anyways, maybe it was this class. I don't remember. I don't think anybody noticed this.
Let me really check my password now.
You've probably forgotten. Everyone forgot. All right, and then in delete statement. So here, we can do the same thing and delete all of the accounts, right, by altering this where clause. So these are, so you can think about, they can steal your data, change your data, or delete your data completely with a SQL injection. So SQL injection, in terms of like severity of types of vulnerabilities, SQL injection is one of the most severe and critical vulnerabilities that can exist in an application, in a web application. So yes, I guess it would go remote code execution on the top because from there you can access the database frequently, and then SQL injection, and then we'll see cross-site scripting with other stuff mixed in. Cool. So other things we can do depending, and this depends on the back-end database engine. So what's the SQL syntax for separating different queries? Semicolon. Yeah, that's part of the SQL. You can actually go and look this up. You can look up the syntax of the SQL language. I literally do this all the time in like CTFs when I'm doing some kind of web attack and I think it may be a SQL injection, and so I have to go look up, okay, I know it's Postgres, so I'm gonna look up the exact syntax of what Postgres does so I can take advantage of the syntax. And so the query separator is semicolon, so if you can use semicolon, you can inject multiple queries, so you can not just do selects, you can do inserts, updates, any query command. So this is if the server allows it. So it's dependent on the server and the web application. Sometimes the web app will add, like change the configuration to allow this.
But for my previous,
go to sleep, all right, bedtime, no. So in this example, so we have our select star from the SA table, the user table or username, and then we have semicolon insert into SA table user password values atom test. So now I've basically, now again, it's all about parsing because the SQL server is going to get this whole string, including the stuff in gray, parse it, and if it recognizes the semicolons and supports multi-statement queries, then it will execute both queries. Which is fairly, I mean, pretty powerful, right? Cool. Okay, the question is, how do we identify these? So what do you think? How would we go about looking for SQL injections? Particularly in a black box manner where we don't have access to the source code.
Yes. So we don't know what the SQL fields are, right? So that's the biggest problem. So we'd have to, like, look at traffic, too.
What traffic?
Like, SQL queries from other users.
Ah, the queries come from the web application to the database, right? So
yeah.
Usually it'll be running locally. If not, they'll be in some data center where we likely do not control.
I see.
But yes, that's the core problem is, yes, we can, if we go back to the other example, we can insert into this table, but we need to know the columns of user and password with the values of admin test. No. Oh, anybody see any keys? Front row keys? You can go ahead and look, don't worry. Do you want to learn about SQL injections? Oh, are they up front, actually? These are mine. Okay, I don't see them up here.
All right, thank you, though. Huh?
Okay, so we need to know the columns in order to insert new columns, or we need to know that in this case, we need to know the column name user and the column name password. And so we need to somehow identify those. What else? So, but that's more about when we know there's a SQL injection, how do we take that to actually exploit things, right? So there's different stages, right? There's identifying, does a SQL injection vulnerability exist? And then there's the exploitation of that vulnerability. Similarly in binaries, right? A buffer overflow, you can detect if one likely exists by giving input of size 10,000. And if it crashes the app, that means there's likely some kind of buffer overflow or something bad is going on. But that doesn't mean you know how to exploit it, right? And some of you have struggled with those phases, right? Going from identifying the vulnerability to exploiting the vulnerability is definitely takes different skills and requires different things, but is equally important. So what else? So what are some ideas?
Yes. The sorting characters.
What was that?
We can black the sorting characters.
Ah, that's all we're trying to find them. So how do we find them using that idea?
You can look at space to look.
How do we look? Because we don't have the source code, right? So we don't know. So again, all we have is that form. So if we go back to our original page, all we have is the HTML form. And we don't see the code at all, and we don't see any queries that the database issues.
You can try using query separators and executing your queries and seeing what happens.
Yeah, we can try. So one thing we can use is we know, or what we've talked about, the SQL Server will likely return a syntax error if there's invalid syntax. So we're going to use the blacklist idea and basically put characters that would be on a blacklist. Single quotes, double quotes, semicolons, parentheses, and see what happens and see if we can cause it to crash. Because if the application is well formed, it should not crash based on that input. Right? It should tell us that that thing doesn't exist. Is that the only way to test? How would we influence the time and execution of the query?
So if you understood that there's a SQL injection, so basically
we're trying to identify SQL injections first. So how do we do that?
Okay, the basic way is to use a syntax error. And in that syntax error, most of the time, it will return you some parts of the query. So you can guess what actually has been before that query. So you can make a basic guess from how you get.
Yeah, so we can do, so kind of a little academic way of thinking this is kind of two ways of a negative approach, in which case you're trying to cause some error to occur, either 500 or sometimes you'll see a literal SQL, like MySQL error message, depending on how the application's coded. So in this case, like what if you put user equals tick or double quote, right? What happens? Does the query fail? Another cool way to think about this, and this actually happens a lot, is to use like a positive approach. So give input that shouldn't mean anything. So let's say if you look at a lot of blogs, there'll be, when you go to the blog post, there'll be like a blog ID, blog ID equals 5. Right? That's the ID there. And so presumably there's some SQL query that says select star from blog where ID equals 5 when you pass it. So what if you do, and the interesting thing about SQL, and it goes back to syntax, is oftentimes, so there's functions like you can add two numbers in your SQL query. So you can look for
blog ID equals 5, you can also do select star where blog ID is equal to 2 plus 3, which should return the exact same page, which doesn't make sense if it's not a SQL engine executing that string. So if you pass 2, so here in this case, 17 plus 5, if that returns the entry for 22, then that's likely a SQL injection. So you're not looking for an error, you're looking for success in this case, which is, I think, an interesting way to think about it. Cool. Okay, and then we have to go into crazy SQL syntax of how powerful a SQL injection vulnerability is. So if we looked at a select statement, so I kind of made a bold claim earlier where I said we can, using any SQL injection, or let's scope it slightly and say any SQL injection that starts with a select statement, without using multiple queries, we can download the entire database. But if I look at the SQL query in the third bullet there, it's select star from accounts. How could I ever get any data out of there besides what's in the accounts table? It seems like not, right? Because it seems like that SQL query is scoped to the accounts table. Because I just tried to drill into your head, you cannot change the stuff that happens before. We can't change that into a select star from users, where we want the user information. We want their credit card information. So it goes back to the union operator. So the union operator allows us to merge the results from two queries. So we can say select star from users where foobar, union select star from other table, and all of those results will be returned in one big query. So for instance, this is a terrible example, but I don't know why the repeat. I don't know what this does. Anyways. So here we're essentially unioning the results of these two queries. Okay, I think. All right. So the idea is we can use this to extract more information from the database. So for instance, so here we have select ID name price from product where brand is equal to some brand, right? So we know that the result set is going to return how many columns? Three columns, right? ID, name, and price. Which means that we can do a union on another table. Okay, so let's look at this. Let's go. Coming back here. Yeah, I should do this more often. All right. So I have ID name price, so I already know that the resulting table is going to be ID name and price. So the first elements that are going to be returned will be the results of whatever this query is. If we then change brand to be foo, tick, space, union, so quiet now. Union select, let's say star from users, because I actually don't care about the products. I can crawl the website and get all the products, right? From users. And I probably don't want where, blah, 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 blah. And I'll do dash, dash to get rid of everything. And there I'm good. So now the query becomes select ID name price from products where brand is equal to foo, union select star from users. This will not work. Why will this not work?
Because we don't have brand column.
What was that?
We don't have brand column. On the table.
No, because the queries are distinct. So we have two different queries here, select queries. We have this select query of select whatever this, and then we have this select query. So I guess the first thing to say are each of these valid queries.
Syntactically valid.
Yes.
Yes. What is the, you can think of, how many columns are returned in the first query? How many columns are returned in the second query? We don't know. What's the user table look like? Well, let's say a user table has ID, name, or you like you name, pass, money, social security number, credit card number, right? So let's say it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It has 6 columns. So actually, I don't know if I'm going to say something wrong, but that's okay. That happens. So it should give us an error because it can't union these two tables together, because one table has 3 columns and the other table has 7 columns. So it fundamentally cannot do that. So how can we change our query to fix that problem?
Give the same number of columns.
Yeah, exactly. So change. So star meant return every column from users. But I know I want 3. ID and then what?
The next ones. So we know that we already are getting the columns 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
Could we get column number 4, 5, and 6 just to try whether it catches the next columns?
Interesting. Okay, so the one thing is actually the names don't matter. The name is going to be used of whatever is in the first column based on the semantics of union. So basically, these results will be essentially appended there. So the code that loops over it doesn't know that it came from this other table. It still thinks like it came from this whatever. It just knows that the return column is named name, ID, name, and price. So the names can be different. But we want, let's say, ID, username, and maybe pass. That could be nice, right? So now this table will say, okay, product one is named Abaz, and the price is 10. And product two is, oh, where brand is foo. Okay, so foo, what would foo brand have? Let's say a bar and a baz. That makes sense. And a baz is much more expensive. And then it's going to union the ID, name, and password from all of the users in the user table. So this will be ID probably 1 again, because there's probably a user of ID 1. The name will probably be admin, and the password will probably be admin. And 2, the next person, Bob, signed up for our thing. He has a very terrible password, but it's a password. And so on and so forth. And when the resulting code, the PHP code, loops over these records, what is it going to likely do for everything that's returned? So what? Where did this query, I mean, imagine some web application showing you all of the products that are from a certain brand. Right? So what does it need? It needs the ID to show you where to go. It needs the name to show you what the name of the product is. It needs the price to show you the price. But again, these are just strings that are being returned. It's iterating over this loop, so it's going to create a product with an ID 1, a name of admin, and a price of admin. The same as an ID 2, a name of Bob, and a price of password. And it will do that for every single user in our table because it just loops over all of the returned results. So by doing this, now we can extract information from other tables. But we had to know some important pieces of information. What did we need to know? So we needed to know the column names, we needed to know the ID, the username, and the pass. What else do we need to know? The table name. We needed to know there was a table named users. That's probably a good guess, but we need to know that. What else do we need to know?
Number of the columns.
We needed to know the number of columns in the original query.
And type of rows.
Right? And possibly the type of the column, depending on the database engine. Yeah, this could fail because price could be a int column, and so it would say that you can't do that union, and it would fail. But we can work around actually 100% all of those issues. So, cool. So one thing, yeah, okay. So one thing we can do is we can return the, we can use the fact that when we give a union, if the number of columns do not match, then it will return a syntax error, like a 500 error. But if it does match, then we're good. But we don't yet know what table we want. So what we can do is we can do union select null, and this will create essentially a row of with one column whose type is null, which could be anything. And so this will succeed only if the original query had only one column. And we can just keep doing this and make iterative approaches, keep going null, null, null. We get to here and it would say, yes, this query succeeded. And we would see an extra product with name, with ID null, name null, and password null, and price null, which would be cool. I'd say we're on the right track. Now we can actually figure out the type of each column first by doing the same thing and putting in a hard-coded string for each of the nulls. And if that succeeds, we know the first column is a string. If that succeeds, we know the second column is a string. If that succeeds, then we know the third column is a string. If it's not a string, then we try integers. We try booleans. We try all the data types of the SQL query. And there, now in a completely black box manner, without knowing anything about the original part of our query, we're able to know how many columns there were and what the type of each column was. But we still need to know the names of the table and possible column names, which is tricky. So there's no standard way to do this in SQL. There's no standard, just give me the table names that you have. But every specific database engine has a way to query what are the tables, what are all the tables in this database? And then for every table, what are the columns in this table? And so from that, you extract information about every table in the database. Then from there, you extract information about every column. And there you start sucking down all the information from all of the columns. So Oracle has a user objects table. Really, you just look this up is the way. MS SQL has this. MySQL is in information_schema.tables. You can extract all the table names. And information_schema.columns table, you can extract all the columns here. And these are standard, so for each of these tables, it is fixed what the column names are and how to query that table for that information. So using these two techniques, you can extract all of the information here. But we have to extract this information how? What was the application doing in order for us to get that username and password? It was querying the database and then returning to us in the HTML result the data from the database. But does the login return us the results of the login? No, all it does is log us in, right? It's a query that we don't see the output of. And this frequently happens, where there'll be multiple queries where you don't directly see the output of. And so, but even without that, so even without the ability to get the output, a SQL injection vulnerability allows you to completely pull down the database. And so the idea here is if you can't, these are called blind SQL injections, and you cannot see the resulting response from the data return. And usually, so what you will get, you do get one bit of information. You get either, well, you know a 500 error if there's an error, and so that's one bit of information, so that's what tells you that there's a SQL injection vulnerability, you'll get some 500. But even if you get no response back on an error message or anything, you can still do that. So imagine a web application that has a press release, so this is just like the blog that has some ID. The SQL query is select title description from press releases where ID is equal to 5, and all the error messages are filtered. So, okay, cool. So the idea is we use this idea of n 1 equals 1. So ID 5 and 1 equals 1 should return what? It should return the page 5. Just the same result as accessing ID equals 5. Right? So this should be exactly the same. So the idea is we know 1 equals 1 is always true, and we can ask Boolean queries of the database engine. Using that, we extract data bit by bit from the SQL server for every query, allowing us to extract all of the data from the database. It is super cool. So we could do something like, we could ask a query like, is the current user's name hacker? Right? We could say 5 and username equals hacker. So if that is true, we know we will get the page with 5. If it's false, we will get an error page that says that there's no ID. There's no page with that name. So that tells us one bit of information. But that's not really enough. But what we can do is we can actually do byte by byte searches on values that we want and use a, what's the thing I'm thinking of? A binary search. Yes, that's the term. Thank you. So we can use a binary search. So we can ask is, we want ID5 and substring of username 11, which is going to give us the first character of the username, and we want to know if that's less than a question mark. And a question mark here, I believe, is kind of in the middle of the alphabet of the ASCII characters. So if that's true, then we know, well, we've, right, binary search, I'm not going to explain it. So that would obviously rule out one half, and then we test the other half until we know exactly what the character is, and then we change it, get the second character, do the same thing, do the next character, so on and so forth. Doing this over and over again. And the cool thing is there are tools out there. There's a tool called SQL Map, SQL Map. Open source tool you can download that will do this 100% for you. So you find the SQL injection, you plug into the tool, and it will download the entire database, which is awesome. Cool. All right, see you on Monday.